Why does eating a healthy diet have to be so complicated? Every week, it's a different headline. People on social media, everybody says something different. Actually, vast majority of this is just distraction. Eating a healthy diet is super simple. In fact, we're about to cover it in three simple steps. Number one, cut the junk. Junk is a loaded term. Sometimes we refer to ultra-processed foods or UPFs. That's also a loaded term at the end of the day. But when it comes down to it, we all know exactly what we're talking about. Take some of the sugary sodas, replace them with tea or coffee or water. Replace the frozen pizza with a piece of salmon and some broccoli. You can steam the broccoli and the salmon at the same time, almost as fast as you can heat up the pizza. Replace your bacon breakfast with an omelet or oats or Greek yogurt. Replace the potato chips snack with some mixed nuts. All of those are massive upgrades. Okay, number two is baby step it. Just replace one meal a week. That's it. Don't try to do everything at once. You're not shooting for perfection. You're not trying to impress anyone. You're shooting for sustainability over the years. We eat 21 meals a week, ballpark. So just try one healthy meal this week. That's it. If you like it, if you find it sustainable, then next week you add a second healthy meal. If you don't like the first meal, don't force it. You're not going to be able to stick with it long term. Change the way you prepare it. Change the types of foods until you find something that is enjoyable, that is satisfying, that you find sustainable. It's better to move slow but get far than try to rush through it and then fall right back to the starting line. That way you learn the ropes as you go along and you avoid major mistakes that set you back. And if you get to a point and you find out that you can't go anymore, it's not sustainable, it's not enjoyable past a certain point, then maybe you stay there or maybe you go back one step, right? So you don't need to fall back to the bottom of the ladder. And this leads me to the third step, divorce the hype. Most people who complain, they're confused about online content. They're being exposed to low quality information. Clickbaity headlines, fear-based wellness gurus. Everything is poison. Everything is toxic. Everything is garbage. Or things are superfoods that you have to eat. Scientists don't talk like this. This is influencer verbiage. The five foods you should never eat. The five foods you have to be eating every day. There is no such thing. This type of videos with these lists is very popular, but the truth is, it's absolute nonsense. The right diet for all humans, there is no such thing. There's a gazillion intolerances and allergies. Almost every single food, somebody is intolerant or allergic to it. So how can the exact same diet be the right diet for every human? This is nonsense. We're feeding our bodies low-quality food, and we're feeding our minds low-quality information. And the two things go hand in hand. Carbs are neither good nor bad. Fat is neither good nor bad. There are high quality foods that are very high carb, and there are high quality foods that are very high fat. Here are some examples of some foods that are high fat and are high quality. Fish, seafood, nuts and seeds, avocado, yogurt, olive oil, canola oil. We consistently see benefits in humans of these foods over and over and over again. Here are some foods that are high in carbs and are high quality. Fruit, oatmeal, lentils, couscous, black beans, quinoa, barley. We consistently see benefits in human beings of consuming these foods over and over and over. Okay, how do I put a meal together with these different foods? Not complicated. Imagine three sections on your plate. Section one, have a protein source. Piece of salmon or chicken breast or mussels or lentils or tempeh. All of those are protein rich. Section two, have some vegetables. Any vegetables. You don't have to eat kale if you don't like kale. It's not a superfood. It's not a food that you have to eat. There's no such thing. Find the vegetables you like. Find the ways of cooking them that you like. And try to mix things up because variety is the spice of life. Most people can't eat the same thing over and over for years and decades. And there's scientific reasons that variety in one's diet is probably healthier. So that's a meal already. Now, that's not a lot of calories. For weight loss, for example, this type of meal structure is really good. Third section, you can add a starch, you can add a whole grain, you can add a second protein if you want. Depends on taste and goals. 99% of nutrition professionals would be down with a diet like this for health. This basic structure is just training wheels. You can personalize this any way you want. Maybe you don't like fish, eat something else. Maybe you're allergic to something. Maybe you're allergic to seafood, don't eat it. Maybe you're an ethical vegan, so you take out the fish and the chicken and you eat the plant foods instead. It's super easy to personalize this while still sticking to the healthy principles. Cut the junk, baby step it, divorce that hype. That's it. Now, let's touch on some frequently asked questions, kind of rapid fire. Eggs, are they good? Are they bad? Are they a superfood? Are they poison? So much confusion. It's really not that complicated. In most of us, eggs raise our cholesterol level modestly. It's a small effect. So if your blood work looks good and you have some eggs here and there, it's not a big deal. Now, there are about 20 or 30% of us that are hyperabsorbers, where eggs or a food like that with cholesterol in it can spike our blood cholesterol really high. So if that's you, consider going easy on the eggs and eating something else instead. We have a whole video on this going over the details. Gluten. Is it poison? Is it killing everybody? Gluten is fine for most people, for 99% of people. If you have celiac, for example, you have to avoid gluten. That's wheat, barley, and rye. You can eat the other grains, and you can eat everything else. There are some other gluten intolerances. Wheat allergy is a thing. So there are specific conditions where people are better off leaving the gluten out. Other than that, for most people, for 99% of people, gluten is absolutely fine. We have a whole video on that covering all the details as well. Red meat, what's the deal? For people who want to include some red meat in their diets, favor the unprocessed kind. So fresh red meat over the hot dogs and bacons. The lean cuts consistently show better health results. So choose a lean cut of meat or trim the visible fat. In general, for health results, what we see with these animal proteins is fish and seafood, usually the best results, then white meat, then red meat. But eating beef once or twice a week in rotation with everything else, we don't see much issue at that level of intake. And we have a whole video on red meat as well. All of these videos I'll link in the description. Organic. Do I need to eat organic? Am I killing myself if I don't? We don't really have strong evidence showing any advantage of organic food, so whatever you prefer. If it makes you feel better, if you feel more relaxed, buy organic. Otherwise, go for conventionally raised. The benefits of eating a healthy diet overall eclipse any effect of organic or not. Seed oils, are they poison? Are they killing everybody? This is a nightmare on social media. The truth is, we mostly see benefit of consuming seed oils in human beings. I am not talking about Burger King or Twinkies that happen to include some seed oil together with another 9,000 ingredients. I'm talking about using the seed oil itself for cooking at home or adding it to your foods. We consistently see health benefits of doing that, especially compared to things like butter, for example, and not much difference when compared to things like olive oil, for example. I mostly consume olive oil and canola oil. Some of our viewers like to eat other seed oils. That's fine. Some people prefer to leave out the seed oils and stick to the olive oil and avocado oil. That's fine too. And some people prefer to leave out all of the oils and have all of their fat from nuts and seeds and avocados and things like that. Also fine. The studies showing head-to-head comparisons of these types of fats don't show a clear, consistent advantage of any of them. So just go with whatever you prefer, as long as you don't go overboard with the calories, because all fats are calorie dense. So as long as it's within reasonable calories. Okay, cooking temperature, what's the deal? In general, you want to stay under the smoke point of the fat that you're using to cook. So you don't want to see a lot of smoke, a lot of black smoke, especially coming out of the pan. Safer cooking techniques are things like boiling, steaming, sauteing, light grilling is okay too. And you want to avoid things like deep frying or charring, burning foods as staples, as things that you do frequently. Artificial sweeteners. What's the deal with that? We have a lot of evidence that artificially sweetened soda, diet soda, is better, is healthier than regular soda. So if the diet soda helps you cut back on the regular soda, on the sugary soda, absolutely use it. And then long term, you can try to wean off the diet soda and move to the waters and the teas and the coffees. But the main thing is to get off the sugary regular soda. Mercury in fish, contamination in fish, does that make fish and seafood unhealthy? This depends on the type of fish. It's mainly a problem up the food chain. With fish like salmon and sardines, which are not very high up the food chain, and are fatty fish, it's been shown that we mainly see cardiovascular benefit of consuming this type of fish, probably due to the healthy fats they contain. So having it a couple times a week is fine and actually recommended compared to a lot of alternatives. If you don't like fish, if you're allergic to fish, if you'd rather avoid fish for ethics or environment or whatever, that's fine. You can get the same omega-3 fats from algae, for example. So here's what an example week might look like for somebody who wants to eat, let's say, an omnivorous diet. Fatty fish a couple times a week, chicken breast a couple times, maybe some clams or some mussels once or twice, beef once or twice, some turkey. Let's say 7 animal protein and 7 plant protein, just as an example. You can change this according to your preference. So 7 plant proteins, lentils, black beans, pinto, tempeh, seitan, edamame, chickpeas. So 14 meals, 7 lunches, 7 dinners, lots of variety. And we're just looking at the protein section here as an example. Obviously, you can mix these, you can combine these, and you don't have to have them dry, plain. You can have them in stews, you can have them in pies, you can have them in salads, you can have them in soup, you can have them in bowls, you can have them in casserole. There's 1,000 options. And then breakfast, we already talked about it. Many options. An omelet, oats with berries, Greek yogurt, some fruit, etc. Many, many options. Okay, lectins. What's the deal? Are they killing us all? Foods that are high in lectins, like beans and lentils, consistently show health benefits in humans consuming them at every level. Heart health, liver health, brain health, risk of death, risk of cancer, body weight, you name it. Don't eat your beans and lentils raw. Other than that, this is simply not a concern for the vast majority of human beings. And if beans give you gas, just baby step it. Remember, step 2, introduce them slowly. Your body gets used to them, your gut bugs get used to them, and you're able to tolerate them just fine. Oxalates. What's the deal with oxalates? Are they killing everybody? If you are a kidney stone former, there are some things to watch out for. But even there, you don't want to eat a diet with 0 oxalates. That's not healthy. We have a whole video with one of the world's leading experts in oxaluria and oxalosis going over all of the tricks. Otherwise, for the majority of people, just not a concern. Have some spinach here and there. Have some other greens. Mix it up. We have internet gurus telling people to be scared of a salad because of oxalates. This is a lot of things, guys, but science is not one of them. Supplements. What's the deal? Are they toxic? Are they necessary? What supplements do I need? Don't waste your money on proprietary supplements. What's a proprietary supplement? It's a supplement that only one guy sells. It's a proprietary mix. They have these markety names like Dr. Joe's Immune Support or Dr. Mary's Gut Shield or Liver Shield and stuff like that. 99% of these supplements were never tested, were never trialed. These proprietary mixes, the guy selling them has no idea if they work, if they provide benefit, if they cause harm. He has no clue. He has no way of knowing it because he didn't test that mix. That's the way the law works, at least in the United States, where I know it a little bit better. The FDA allows you to sell a supplement mix that was never tested. So unless they can show you a specific trial of their mix, of their supplement, don't buy this stuff. Don't waste your money. And then for generic supplements, that's basically molecules, nutrients that you can buy anywhere, like a B6 supplement or a vitamin C supplement. If you're on a balanced diet, you don't need the vast majority of this because you're getting those from your diet. Supplements are good for people who have a specific deficiency. They're lacking one nutrient. Their blood work shows that. So they top it up with a supplement. Or someone's diet doesn't have enough of a nutrient, so they supplement it with a supplement, right? Typical example of that are vegans. Vegans need a source of B12, either a fortified food or a supplement. Otherwise, vast majority of supplements, you just don't need them. One supplement that has some interesting evidence behind it is creatine, both for athletic performance and also there's some evidence on brain health. We have a recent video where I went over it, and I don't sell creatine. I have no affiliation, no connection to any of the makers. Fructose. Oh my God, the fructose. What's the deal with fructose? If we're talking high fructose corn syrup and these ultra processed foods with concentrated purified fructose, yes, we see consistently bad outcomes, bad health outcomes of those foods. If we're talking an apple or a peach or some grapes, we consistently see good health outcomes, good health results of eating those foods for body weight, for liver health, etc., etc. So absolutely include some whole fruit in your diet and don't let these influencers scare you with names of molecules. Cut the junk, baby step it, divorce that hype. That's it, my friends. Simple. Here's a lot more information on oxalates, all the details, and here's a lot more on artificial sweeteners. Check those out. I'll meet you in there. Take care.